gather here in Jesus' name. His love is burning in our hearts like a living flame. For through his loving Son, the Father makes us one. Come take the bread, come drink the wine, come share the Lord. We'll gather soon where angels sing. We'll see the glory of our Lord and coming King. Now we anticipate the feast for which we wait. Come take the bread, come drink the wine, come share the Lord, for he will feed us with his presence here. The bread and wine will do us good. Our deepest hungers he will satisfy, for he is life and peace and rest and drink and food. From the dead, the one we love the most is now our gracious host. Come take the bread, come drink the wine, come share the Lord. Come take the bread, come drink the wine, come share the
Friends, grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. It is a joy to be with you in God's house on this Lord's Day. And I am joined by two excellent students of our church, Ms. Lexi and Grant, and we have some very important announcements for you. And as we gather, I want to remind us that no matter who we are, no matter where we've come from, Jesus Christ welcomes you to this table of amazing grace. Mr. Grant, I'll see if I can find a microphone. And Mr. Grant, what is your announcement for us today?
We are the baptized children of God.
We are indeed. Thank you. And Ms. Lexi.
Jesus is the light of the world, and he says we are the light of the world too.
Amen. Thank you so much. We'll light that candle reminding us that Jesus is here. And if you want, I can just take that. You got it. Way to go, Lexi. And Grant, thank you so much for your help this morning. You're welcome to join your families. Friends, in your bulletin, there are a number of announcements for our faith community, and a few we would like to point out to you. Our Ted Lasso series will resume at the Good Apple Tap House on Monday, January the 29th. We're going to be watching the full episode, and we're going to be focusing on three episodes for the three-session series. The first is Images of the God Figure. The second is The Power of Forgiveness. And third is The Transformative and Amazing Power of Belief. So if you enjoy a beverage, we'd be happy to share three evenings with you beginning next Monday at the Good Apple Tap House. Ms. Meg.
On January 28th, following the service, the worship service, there will be a congregational meeting. This is where we tend to the business of the church and take votes. And I hear the orders of business are very exciting coming up. And so you shouldn't miss it.
It could be a 5-minute meeting. We'll see.
You never know.
Friends, last week we shared with you that God has really just blessed our congregation with a number of youth, and we want to minister to our children and students who are middle school and high school age. God has been good to us. Miss Meg has been nurturing wonderful seeds in our youth ministry, so it is time for us to hire a part-time youth director, coordinator. So if you know someone in your circle of friends who has some extra time, who loves Jesus, who loves our kids, we're trying to just get the news out there that we're ready to make that step to nurture our kids in Jesus Christ.
Speaking of our youth, Katie Shevlin and the Growing Covenant team have planned a youth group activity also Sunday, January 28th at 4 p.m. We are going to be meeting over in Eagle at Eagle Island State Park at the Tubing Hill, having an afternoon of tubing, and then following tubing, you'll be going to Idaho Pizza Company for pizza.
It'll be a fun day. I'll be there. Hey, does anyone watch the television series The Chosen? Some of us have, some of us haven't. I commend it, an excellent series portraying the beauty of Jesus. Some of those actors are going to be in Nampa on February the 10th at the Ford Center, and there is an interfaith group encouraging church folks to go and listen to the testimony of these actors. You do need a ticket, but the tickets are free. So if you are interested in attending that event on February the 10th, there are tickets at the Connection Center, and if you have questions about that, just let me know.
Okay, and this is just a minor matter of housekeeping, but we wanted to remind parents we're doing something a little bit new with Sunday school. And so if you are a parent to a preschooler through third grader, if you could come back and pick up your child from Sunday school, that would be really helpful. Our fourth through sixth graders will be dismissed along with the congregation as you're dismissed from worship service. But if you're a pre-K through third parent, we'd love for you to come back so we can see your face and do the handoff.
Terrific. Thanks, Meg. Mm-hmm. For this last announcement, you've got to understand that you hired kind of a weird, geeky pastor, right? I have not been this excited for a minute for mission in a long time. So I want to invite Ms. Melinda Schulder to come forward to share with us something really cool happening here in just a few weeks.
We have decided to do a special dance for our young members of church. We're calling it our Someone Special Dance. And what we are wanting is, or hoping, is that all of our young members, all of our children, will invite someone special to this dance. A dad, a mom, both dad and mom, grandma, grandpa, any adult that they deem is their special someone. They can invite more than one. I know Grant said he's inviting both me and his dad to come to the dance with him. It is going to be February 3rd, so it'll be a Valentine's Day themed dance. We're hoping for this to become an annual event, our little Someone Special dance. It'll be from 6:30 to 8:30 p.m. We are going to ask us for your admission into the dance, that you bring a donation for our church pantry, and we'll have a list of some items that our pantry is in more need of. So we're not overloading on just mac and cheese, that we get more things that our pantry needs. We're going to have some games. We'll have dance. Casey Timmerman's going to be our DJ, so that's going to be awesome. I'm really excited what he's got ready for us. We'll have some games in the Van Wyck room, some craft things, so those that don't want to do too much dancing, they'll have that opportunity as well. And then also, for all of our more mature, maybe, members. If you have someone special in your family, a child that you would like to invite, please bring them. That is also what we are hoping to set up too. So it doesn't just have to be our children in church inviting their someone special. If there's a grandma or grandpa in here, or aunt and uncle, and you've got that special niece or nephew that you would like to invite, or both, please invite them and show up, and we'll get down and boogie. So thank you.
Nurturing healthy relationships. That's what church is about. Relationships with our family, with one another, with the Lord. So let's come boogie on February the 3rd. Well, friends, it is this hour that we take in our lives and we say, I'm going to put away my anxieties. I'm going to set aside my to-do list. And for this hour, we give our hearts to our Lord Jesus as we continue to dive deeper into our worship. Will you pray with me? Almighty God, in whom we live and move and have our being, we pray that you would be with us in this time, that this service would not be about my favorite songs or my favorite announcements, but that this service we would offer in praise and glory to you. So, Lord, pour your Spirit upon our hearts that we may worship you worthily and bring praise and glory to your magnificent name. We pray this in the most powerful name in the universe, our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us stand and sing together our opening hymn.
What more can he say than to you he has said, to you who for refuge to Jesus have fled? Fear not, I am with thee. Oh, be not dismayed, for I am.
Our sermon series is Words We Live By. We've been picking out words that we say almost every week. So these next words I say almost every week, but I encourage you to listen to them with fresh ears. If we say that we have no sin, we only deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive us all of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. In a spirit of humility and authenticity, I encourage you to join me in the prayer of confession that is found on the screen behind me. Let us pray. Most merciful God, we confess
that we are in bondage to sin and we cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by all we have done and by all we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us.
Friends, the good news of the gospel is this, is that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Christ rose in victory for us. And Paul tells us that at this very moment, Jesus sits at the right hand of the Father and prays for you and for all of us. Friends, hear and believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are loved and we are forgiven. Amen. Friends, as the forgiven people of God, we are called to be the forgiving people of God. And we practice that here in worship as we greet our neighbor saying, "The peace of the Lord be with you." And we can respond by saying, "And also with you." Sure, a sign of peace.
It is time for our family engagement time. So if I could have all of the kids join me up here. We have a few things to talk about this morning. Oh, got some brother and sister love. It's always fun. My goodness, can I help you? Look at all these kids. So fun. Okay, I have at least three things I'm really excited about today to share with you. You guys, we have five new Sunday school teachers this morning. Can you even believe it? Five new ones. So we're gonna have to all work together and help each other and no tricks. Right? There will be no tricks. We're so thankful and so excited that there are adults who are really excited to spend time with you guys in class today. Secondly, it's someone's birthday in our kids' ministry. Whose birthday is it? Do you want to share how old you are today? Do you want to say it? It's Estelle's birthday, and she is?
Five.
She's a whole hand. Happy birthday, Estelle. And then the last thing is I'm really excited about what we're going to talk about today. And I think I've already asked this before once, but have any of you ever been left behind without your parents realizing it, or been lost? I remembered this story, and that's why I brought it up again. Laurel, do you just want to remind us? Do you want to tell us what happened? Okay. We'll let you tell your story. Okay.
I was in the nursery, and my dad went home without me.
How long? Do you know, Laurel, this didn't just happen to you. This happened to Jesus. When he was 12 years old, their family had a tradition to go to the temple in Jerusalem. And they went. And Jesus went, and we'll hear what he says, where he was. But they all traveled together, and they were there, and they worshiped God. And then Mary and Joseph and a big group of people left, and they all went back home. But Jesus was left in the temple. And he was left there, and we don't know exactly how long. But Mary and Joseph are walking with all their friends and extended family, and they said, "Where's Jesus?" And no one knew where he was. And Mary and Joseph, they say, well, we must have left him back there. So they go running back to the temple, and sure enough, Jesus was there sitting and listening to the teachings. And he told his parents, "You didn't have to worry about me. I was in my Father's house." Isn't that cool? And that's where we are today, right? In our Father's house. But we're going to learn more about that story and talk about some traditions that we do, and then you can share other stories where you might have been left behind. Does that sound good? All right, so we will take off today, and we're singing our new song. Okay.
God's going with me.
God's going with me. And
he's right beside me. He's right beside me. To my door. Oh, 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 oh.
God's going with me.
God's going with me.
And
he's never gonna leave me.
And
I don't ever have to walk alone. Cause God is with me wherever I go.
God's going with me.
God's going with me.
He's right beside me.
to walk alone, cause God is with me wherever I go.
Morning, everyone. The scripture reading today is from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 3, verses 9 through 20. It can be found on the overhead screen behind me or on page 117 in the New Testament section of your pew Bibles. Will you pray with me, please? Lord God, let the words of your servant's mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing in your sight. O Lord, our rock and redeemer through Christ. Amen. Romans 3, 9 through 20. Sisters and brothers, listen for the word of God. What then? Are we any better off? No, not at all. For we have already charged that all, both Jews and Greeks, are under the power of sin, as it is written. There is no one who is righteous, not even one. There is no one who has understanding. There is no one who seeks God. All have turned aside. Together they have become worthless. There is no one who shows kindness. There is not even one. Their throats are open graves. They use their tongues to deceive. The venom of vipers is under their lips. Their mouths are full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Ruin and misery are in their paths, and the way of peace they have not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. Now that we know that, whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For no human will be justified before him by deeds prescribed by the law, for through the law comes the knowledge of sin. This is the word of the Lord.
Who here hasn't forgot their kids sometime? I want to remind Ms. Simmons that staff evaluations are coming forth quickly. She was wise to share that on the day we talk about confessing our sins, right? Well, friends, I do want to talk about sin, and as Meg pointed out, yes, I am chief amongst them. And Father Anthony Bloom, who is a 20th century Eastern Orthodox priest, Metropolitan of New York, was known for writing about sin, spirituality, and he gave this sermon to his church. It is often quoted as Father Bloom's shortest sermon, so I'm going to read it verbatim. It's on a Sunday like today, and Father Bloom gets up and he says these words. Last night, a woman with a child came to this church. She was in trousers and with no headscarf, and someone scolded her for not dressing properly. She left. I don't know who did that, but I am commanding that person to pray for her and her child to the end of his days to God for their salvation. Because of you, she may never come to church again. And then he turned around, head down, and entered the altar. And that was the entire sermon. So friends, who sinned? Was it Father Bloom for that short sermon, not earning his paycheck that week? No, y'all are ready to make the guy a saint for keeping his sermon short. Was it the person who scolded the woman who left church? Or was it the woman not recognizing that God is much deeper and more real than the hypocrites who gather in the pews week after week? If we say that we are without sin, We deceive only ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Sin. What is this thing that we call sin, my friends? Someone said a few weeks ago, Kevin, you're not necessarily a hellfire and brimstone preacher. We'll look out today. You'll appreciate Father Blue much more after today. Our second scripture reading comes to us from 1 John chapter 1, verses 5 through 10. Listen for the word of the Lord. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not do that which is true. But if we walk in the light, as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. Sisters and brothers, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. What is this thing that we call sin that sometimes we're hesitant to talk about and we're not apt to share those days we left our daughter at church? I only made it like a few miles down the road before I realized that my daughter, who was still being supervised by folks at the church, were still here. But what do we do with this thing called sin? What is it? How powerful is it? Do we really believe that sin exists? So let's dive deep into the etymology of this word. Where does it come from and what does it mean? In the Old Testament scriptures, the Jews were very aware that sin was very real and a recognition of a broken relationship between an individual and Yahweh, or an individual and someone else. It always described a brokenness, because in God's grand design in the garden, humans were supposed to walk with God and the world would be perfect, right? Well, guess what quickly comes into the story in chapter 3 of Genesis? Sin, a breaking of the relationship between God and Adam and Eve. And we've lived in a history of sinfulness since then, where we are apt to believe that serpent, that we know better than God, don't we? And we make decisions and do our actions in contradiction to God's intention for the world and for ourselves. And as this word sin comes to us in the Old Testament, God gives us the sacrificial system. There's 613 imperatives of which God's people were supposed to follow. And when we broke those, we would go to the temple and we would make sacrifices to restore the broken relationship between God and with one another. This continues into the New Testament. This idea of sin that we continue to know very full well. Sin appears in the Christian New Testament 173 times, amartia. And I want to break down that Greek word, a. We continue to use it in the English language, right? When we say we are agnostic, without knowledge. Or when our atheist friends say, I'm an atheist. A is with a without or not theism, belief in God. So, a maros. The other side of that Greek word of which we get amartia is like a fulfillment or a fullness or a sharing the whole of. Amartia is without the fullness. And it's actually an archery word. When you take your bow and your arrow and you try to hit the mark, but you miss, the missing of the mark. And I want to talk about how the sacrifice required of sin continues forth. But let's talk about sin. As Meg called me out, what are the sins in your life? This is one of those times where we can be Pentecostal and stand up and said, I did X, Y, Z. No, not really. But I do want to name those times and situations to reinforce the reality of sinfulness and this world and its consequences. Because we don't necessarily like to talk about sin, but I want us to just look around our culture and be mindful that we live in a world that is so focused on the material. We go to work so we can buy things, and we go back to work so we can pay for those things. And we live in a world that's full of stuff. Am I right? We live in a world that's full of vacations and satisfying our belly or satisfying those other needs in our life, those things that we hesitate to talk about in the church. But Dr. Cornel West, in a lecture that he gave at the Berkeley School of Theology, reminds us that in our culture, everything is for sale these days. Everybody is for sale. A direct violation of the first commandment. And yet our culture just says, well, this is the way it is. We live in a material world. And as Madonna says, and I'm a material girl. Our American culture is so focused on success. How are you doing at your job? How's it going? How's the move up the corporate ladder? Are you the best teacher in the West Ada School District? We are so focused on being the best at what we do that we forget about the life that God has called us to, a life filled with integrity and truth and respect. But our culture doesn't talk about those things, do we? If we look at the NCAA football transfer pool, those things that we used to appreciate about loyalty and teamwork have devolved all about money, selfishness, and getting ahead. And all of us, including myself, sorry for all you sports fans who aren't getting the analogy, but if you're a sports fan, we just say, that's the way of the world where it's all about money these days. Am I right? And success. That part of us that laments the loss of teamwork and loyalty. And again, once more, we place this climb of the corporate ladder of being the best that you can be aside when we forget to say, how can I be the best that God has created me to be? How often as a culture do we talk about that? How often parents in this room, we have a growing youth ministry, thanks be to God, right? But I'm looking at me and I'm looking at my other parents out there, my age and older and younger. What are we teaching our kids when we say, oh, let's go to the baseball game on Sunday morning? Because one day you might be a Major League Baseball player. I use the straw man analogy, but I want us to look inside of our hearts because I might just be just as guilty with it because the sins of the culture are so rampant and so unnamed. How are we teaching our kids about the ways of God? And then there's this thing that's called ego. Can ask my wife. I have a very large one myself, right? But you and your neighbor, these things and ideas of, well, if only they had the right theology, then the world would be much better. Or, oh, if only they voted for this person because I know what's right, and if they would only just listen to me. And we say these things fleetingly, but how often do we approach our neighbor in attitudes like that, where we fail to confess our own sin, and we are so quick to look at the sins of others. All these abstract sins that I'm naming, I also want to talk about this idea of anxiety. And I'm a practical theologian. I know there are some psychologists in this room. But how many of us live anxiously? From paycheck to paycheck, worrying about the relationship that we have with our parents, with our kids, with our siblings, and we become anxious and fearful, and these places of fear and anxiety begin to be the primary motivations of our life. We're coming into an election year, am I right? How many of us are anxious about this? I see some heads nodding, right? Now, I don't necessarily want to go into politics, but the polls, talking about the opinion, tell me that most of us don't want the two people that will probably be the folks that we're voting for. And over the next year, folks are going to be anxious. What if he wins? Or what if she wins? And folks, I don't know much about politics, but I do know a little bit about Jesus. And there is a Lord and Savior who comes to us no matter where we are in life and looks us in the eye and says, "Do not fear." The prophet says, "I am with you. I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. Do not fear." And what do? We walk around anxiously fearful. And I'm looking at myself in the mirror. All these sins that are real, motivating our lives. And sometimes we live in a church that's hesitant to step on anyone's toes. And then there's this last aspect of sin. Those sins that we'd rather not talk about. But you know what they are. Those issues of anger or control, pride, gluttony, slothfulness. And if we look around the world, we see the manifestations of sin, don't we? We're so quick to look at the Ukraine, to look at Gaza, say sin is real. Paul tells us that the wages of sin is what? Death. Do we believe that, my friends? Or we just go on living in our ego, well, if the world would just think like me, how much better would we all be? Whew. Sins. In the prayer we say, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and we cannot free ourselves. And then we wonder why the self-help section at Barnes & Noble is so popular and profitable. We are in bondage to sin and we cannot free ourselves, but God's love for us was so much that Paul writes to the church in Rome, God proves his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Much more surely, therefore, since we have now been justified by his blood, will we be saved through him from the wrath. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his Son, much more surely, having been reconciled, we will be saved by his life. But more than that, we even boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we now have received reconciliation. Did you hear, Paul? Your reconciliation with God doesn't come from anything you do or you don't do. It comes by God's grace poured out to you in Christ. It is through Christ we are saved. So what are we to do with all this sin that kills us? We remember that Christ saves us from that. And then we go out and we talk about what wonderful good Presbyterians we are, right? No, Paul says that if we're going to boast, we don't boast in our actions or about how good we are. We boast in God through Jesus, who saves us from all of this sin, who saves us from ourselves. We boast in Christ. So individuals, today, in the sinful world that we live in, do we acknowledge its truth? And I want to talk about like how individually we respond to the reality of sin. And then I want to talk about how as the church we respond to sin in this world. So individually, one, the first thing that we do is we confess our sins. We do it every week in worship, and it can become so routine. But we do it weekly in front of God Himself and in front of our neighbors to remind ourselves that, yes, we are caught up in the snarls of sin, and we can't save ourselves. The second thing that we do is we turn to Jesus, the one who we believe does save us from our sins, that there is power in the blood of Christ that was shed for me, shed for you, for the redemption of all of creation. So we confess, we turn to Jesus, and then we do this word the Presbyterians don't like. We repent. Sometimes that sounds like a scary evangelical word, but most basically at its roots, it means to return or turn around, return to the God who loved you. Jesus tells this beautiful story in John chapter 8. A woman who was caught in adultery. And the law says the woman who was caught in adultery should be stoned to death. So there's the woman. Picture this. And the crowd is gathering around, picking up their stones. And your Lord and Savior says, let he who is without sin cast the first stone. A beautiful story of how God loves especially the sinners and the tax collectors and the prostitutes. It's beautiful. But what does Jesus add at the end of that story? He doesn't say, oh, go and continue being an adulteress. He says, go and sin no more. And folks, I wonder if we need to hear that message today as we consider all those sins that we talked about. What does it mean for all of us to turn to Jesus and sin no more? And we say all of this because remember the garden story, right? Humanity walked with God. It was beautiful. That was God's intention, not just for Adam and Eve, but for all of us, so that we may dwell with God and God would dwell with us. And if you turn your Bibles back to the end of the story in Revelation 21, the visions of the world that is to come, God will restore that relationship. Well, there will be no more crying and no more tears. Death will be gone forever. And God will dwell with his people and his people will dwell with him. This is the end of the story, whether you like it or not. So we may as well start preparing for that today. That we would walk with God. That he would hold our hands and hold our hearts. And look you in the eye and said, I have loved you since the beginning of time and will love you into eternity. And it is that person that we grow into that is beautiful and truthful and good. That is the person that you were created to be. So let us begin growing into that now. So church, what do we do with all of this sin in the world? I think we got to talk about it. The sin is real. The sin is evil. That we look at what happened in Israel on October 6th, and say, that is evil. And we must also say that governments who treat people unjustly, that is also sinful and evil. No one is innocent in this world. That the world is complicated, and we're all sinners. And what is the only thing that will save us? Sure isn't going to be a presidential candidate. See, church, we got to talk about the reality of sin. And we don't like to judge people, because hopefully we're listening to Jesus when he says, judge not, lest you also be judged. So if we're not going to judge others, we need to look into ourselves. And we need to proclaim, live, and love the gospel of Jesus. I'm grateful to God for the number of kids in our church. It's beautiful. I look at the statistics of kids in our society that don't go to church or synagogue or the mosque. And we have a bunch of kids growing up in an incredibly dominant culture that says you are your own God. You get to make your own meaning. And it's disheartening. And I want to say, church, where are we? What message are we giving our kids? And then I wonder about the church and the global West. And I ask myself the questions, are we setting the example for our kids and being passionate about what we believe is the gospel truth? Or are we just going along with the culture? Kids, I want you to be successful, get a good job. You know, I would much rather my children hang out with the deacons of this church than hang out with the top 10 CEOs in the city of Boise, who may or may not be good people, I don't know. But I want them to learn that there is things more important in our lives than the pursuit of the almighty dollar. And our kids need examples of people who believe in the goodness of Jesus to show them the way that they would grow up. And I hope that we can create a church who is passionate about this good news that begins with, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. May we keep going to the cross in everything that we do. And everything that we say and believe, pointing people to the love of Jesus. And I close with this quote from Maximus the Confessor, another Eastern Orthodox person. And he says, he who busies himself with the sins of others or judges his brother on suspicion has not yet even begun to examine himself so as to discover his own sins. So friends, let us be mindful of our own hearts, giving them to Jesus, allowing him to transform our lives that we may know his goodness and to share that light with all whom we encounter. Let's pray. Lord, help us to know the reality of sin and its wages. Help us to know the beauty and the goodness of the gospel. Help us to live that and to love you. And as we begin to allow your beauty to transform ourselves, we pray that you would allow our lives to point to your goodness, that your love would continue to transform this world. We pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let us stand as we sing together our next hymn, Oceans.
I will go.
Friends, you may be seated. And as we do so, I encourage you to be mindful of that sacrifice made for our sins, the final and most perfect sacrifice. And as God has given all of himself, what shall we return in light of the Lord's goodness? If you're worshiping online, you can give online. And will the ushers come forward to receive the offering? Is full of beauty. Life can be full of tragedy. And as we come to our time of prayer, we take the fullness of life and we give it to God. Let's Continue to be in prayer for our friend Carol Wallace, who has transitioned from St. Al's to a rehabilitation facility. Let's be praying for the family of Sue Sterling, as Stu lost her brother this past week in death. We lift up Norm Poole, who is Tom Greco's friend, in the hospital at 95 years old. Pray that God would bring healing and strength. Our friend Pam Sawyer is having a full knee replacement tomorrow. Pray for her and that Steve will be a good nurse to his beautiful wife. We pray for Rob Wheeler, who's taken ordination exams this week. Hopefully these are his last two. We pray for our elders, Penny Sartori, who's having a heart procedure February 13th, Bill Martin, who's having shoulder surgery in February. We pray for our friend Naomi Alward, who in a tragic turn of events this past week lost both a son and a grandson. We hold these things in the fullness of life. We celebrate with our friends, the Chamberlains, on the arrival of Miles Cooper, celebrating the newness and joy of life that God gives to us. We celebrated Estelle's birthday. Tom Greco had a birthday yesterday, and one of the queens of our congregation, Ms. Wilma Perez, is turning 29-ish today. So we give thanks to God for the gift of life. Can I tell them your real age or no? No. Can I offer your true age? 91 years young today. My mother will give me a talking to in my dreams after that. Sorry. And then finally, we pray for our youth director, right? We don't know who this person is, but we're going to pray that God brings us someone who loves Jesus and loves our kids so that we can teach them the truth about God's salvation and plan for all of our lives. Let's pray. Lord, there is a lot to give to you today. We pray that we would not just give these names and situations. We pray that you would give us the courage to give you our whole hearts and our whole lives. As you have died for us, help us to die to our egos so that we would live for the glory and honor of your name. Pray this in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let us stand and sing our closing hymn. This is Amazing Grace.
Shame.
Friends, would you go home? And in this world of sin that we live, tell your loved ones, your kids, your neighbors, all about those things that we just sang about, all that Jesus has done for us. Friends, I remind you that Stephen and Carrie Downer will be sharing their class on origins in this space. Childcare is provided. If you have pre-K through grade 3, if you'll head down and go pick them up. But friends, in this sinful world, Christ loves us, so go and share this love that will save us. And may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord be kind and gracious to you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen and amen.